Abdu'l-Bahá, Abdu'l-Bahá, Persian, May 23, 1844, November 28, 1921, born Abbas, was the eldest son of Bahá'u'lláh and served as head of the Bahá'í Faith from 1892 until 1921. Abdu'l-Bahá was later canonized as the last of three central figures of the religion, along with Bahá'u'lláh and the Bab, and his writings and authenticated talks are regarded as a source of Bahá'í sacred literature. He was born in Tehran to an aristocratic family. At the age of 8, his father was imprisoned during a government crackdown on the Bábí Faith and the family's possessions were looted, leaving them in virtual poverty. His father was exiled from their native Iran, and the family went to live in Baghdad, where they stayed for 9 years. They were later called by the Ottoman state to Istanbul before going into another period of confinement in Edirne and finally the prison city of Akká, Acre. Abdu'l-Bahá remained a political prisoner there until the Young Turk Revolution freed him in 1908 at the age of 64. He then made several journeys to the west to spread the Bahá'í message beyond its Middle Eastern roots, but the onset of World War I left him largely confined to Haifa from 1914 to 1918. The war replaced the openly hostile Ottoman authorities with the British Mandate, who united him for his help in averting famine following the war. In 1892, Abdu'l-Bahá was appointed in his father's will to be his successor and head of the Bahá'í Faith. He faced opposition from virtually all his family members, but held the loyalty of the great majority of Bahá'ís around the world. His tablets of the Divine Plan helped galvanize Bahá'ís in North America into spreading Bahá'í teachings to new territories, and his will and testament laid the foundation for the current Bahá'í administrative order. Many of his writings, prayers and letters are extant, and his discourses with the Western Bahá'ís emphasize the growth of the faith by the late 1890s. Abdu'l-Bahá's given name was Abbas. Depending on context, he would have gone by either Mirza Abbas, Persian, or Abbas Effendi, Turkish, both of which are equivalent to the English Sir Abbas. He preferred the title of Abdu'l-Bahá, servant of Bahá, a reference to his father. He is commonly referred to in Bahá'í texts as the Master. Abdu'l-Bahá was born in Tehran, Iran on May 23, 1844, 5th of Jamadi Urlavel, 1260, the eldest son of Bahá'u'lláh and Nawab. He was born on the very same night on which the Bab declared his mission. Born with the given name of Abbas, he was named after his grandfather Mirza Abbas Nuri, a prominent and powerful nobleman. As a child, Abdu'l-Bahá was shaped by his father's position as a prominent Babi. He recalled how he met the Babi Tahira and how she would take me onto her knee, caress me, and talk to me. I admired her most deeply. Abdu'l-Bahá had a happy and carefree childhood. The family's Tehran home and country houses were comfortable and beautifully decorated. Abdu'l-Bahá enjoyed playing in the gardens with his younger sister, with whom he was very close. Along with his younger siblings, a sister, Bahi'i, and a brother, Mahdi, the three lived in an environment of privilege, happiness and comfort. With his father declining a position as minister of their royal court, during his young boyhood Abdu'l-Bahá witnessed his parents' various charitable endeavors, which included converting part of the home to a hospital ward for women and children. Abdu'l-Bahá received a haphazard education during his childhood. It was customary not to send children of nobility to schools. Most noblemen were educated at home briefly in scripture, rhetoric, calligraphy and basic mathematics. Many were educated to prepare themselves for life in the royal court. Despite a brief spell at a traditional preparatory school at the age of 7 for 1 year, Abdu'l-Bahá received no formal education. As he grew, he was educated by his mother and uncle. Most of his education, however, came from his father. Years later, in 1890, Edward Granville Brown described how Abdu'l-Bahá was one more eloquent of speech, more ready of argument, more apt of illustration, more intimately acquainted with the sacred books of the Jews, the Christians, and the Mohammedans, scarcely be found even amongst the eloquent. When Abdu'l-Bahá was 7, he contracted tuberculosis and was expected to die. Though the malady faded away, he would be plagued with bouts of illness for the rest of his life. One event that affected Abdu'l-Bahá greatly during his childhood was the imprisonment of his father when Abdu'l-Bahá was 8 years old, the imprisonment led to his family being reduced to poverty and being attacked in the streets by other children. Abdu'l-Bahá accompanied his mother to visit Bahá'u'lláh and was then imprisoned in the infamous subterranean dungeon the Siachal. He described how I saw a dark, steep place. We entered a small, narrow doorway, and went down 2 steps, but beyond those one could see nothing. In the middle of the stairway, all of a sudden we heard his, Bahá'u'lláh's, voice, do not bring him in here, and so they took me back. Bahá'u'lláh was eventually released from prison but ordered into exile, and Abdu'l-Bahá then 8 joined his father on the journey to Baghdad in the winter January to April of 1853. During the journey Abdu'l-Bahá suffered from frostbite. After a year of difficulties Bahá'u'lláh absented himself rather than continue to face the conflict with Mirza Yahya and secretly secluded himself in the mountains of Sulaymaniyah in April 1854, a month before Abdu'l-Bahá's 10th birthday. Mutual sorrow resulted in him, his mother and sister becoming constant companions. Abdu'l-Bahá was particularly close to both, and his mother took active participation in his education and upbringing. During the two-year absence of his father Abdu'l-Bahá took up the duty of managing the affairs of the family, before his age of maturity, 14 in Middle Eastern society, and was known to be occupied with reading and, at a time of hand-copied scriptures being the primary means of publishing, was also engaged in copying the writings of the Bab. Abdu'l-Bahá also took an interest in the art of horse riding and, as he grew, became a renowned writer. In 1856, news of an ascetic carrying on discourses with local Sufi leaders that seemed to possibly be Bahá'u'lláh reached the family and friends. Immediately, family members and friends went to search for the elusive dervish, and in March brought Bahá'u'lláh back to Baghdad. On seeing his father, Abdu'l-Bahá fell to his knees and wept loudly, "Why did you leave us?" And this followed with his mother and sister doing the same. Abdu'l-Bahá soon became his father's secretary and shield. During the sojourn in the city Abdu'l-Bahá grew from a boy into a young man. He was noted as a remarkably fine-looking youth, and remembered for his charity and amiableness. Having passed the age of maturity Abdu'l-Bahá was regularly seen in the mosques of Baghdad discussing religious topics and the scripture as a young man. Whilst in Baghdad, Abdu'l-Bahá composed a commentary at the request of his father on the Muslim tradition of I was a hidden treasure for a Sufi leader named Ali Shokat Pasha. Abdu'l-Bahá was 15 or 16 at the time and Ali Shokat Pasha regarded the more than 11,000-word essay as a remarkable feat for somebody of his age. In 1863 in what became known as the Garden of Rezvan Bahá'u'lláh announced to a few that he was the manifestation of God and he whom God shall make manifest whose coming had been foretold by the Bab. On day 8 of the 12 days, it is believed Abdu'l-Bahá was the first person Bahá'u'lláh revealed his claim to. In 1863 Bahá'u'lláh was summoned to Constantinople, Istanbul, and thus his whole family including Abdu'l-Bahá, then 19, accompanied him on his 110-day journey. The journey to Constantinople was another wearisome journey, and Abdu'l-Bahá helped feed the exiles. It was here that his position became more prominent amongst the Bahá'ís. This was further solidified by Bahá'u'lláh's tablet of the branch in which he constantly exalts his son's virtues and station. The family were soon exiled to Adrianople and Abdu'l-Bahá went with the family. Abdu'l-Bahá again suffered from frostbite. In Adrianople Abdu'l-Bahá was regarded as the sole comforter of his family, in particular to his mother. At this point Abdu'l-Bahá was known by the Bahá'ís as the master, and by non-Bahá'ís as Abbas Effendi. Effendi signifies sir. It was in Adrianople that Bahá'u'lláh referred to his son as the Mystery of God. The title of Mystery of God symbolizes, according to Bahá'ís, that Abdu'l-Bahá is not a manifestation of God but how a person of Abdu'l-Bahá the incompatible characteristics of a human nature and superhuman knowledge and perfection have been blended and are completely harmonized. Abdu'l-Bahá was at this point noted for having black hair which flowed to his shoulders, large blue eyes, rose through alabaster-colored skin and a fine nose. Bahá'u'lláh gave his son many other titles such as Qasni-Azam, meaning mightiest branch or mightier branch, the branch of holiness, the center of the covenant and the apple of his eye. Abdu'l-Bahá, the master, was devastated when hearing the news that he and his family were to be exiled separately from Bahá'u'lláh. It was, according to Bahá'ís, through his intercession that the idea was reverted and the family were allowed to be exiled together. At the age of 24, Abdu'l-Bahá was clearly chief steward to his father and an outstanding member of the Bahá'í community. Bahá'u'lláh and his family were, in 1868, exiled to the penal colony of Acre, Palestine where it was expected that the family would perish. Arrival in Akká was distressing for the family and exiles. They were greeted in a hostile manner by the surrounding population and his sister and father fell dangerously ill. When told that the women were to sit on the shoulders of the men to reach the shore, Abdu'l-Bahá took a chair and carried the women to the Bay of Akká. Abdu'l-Bahá was able to procure some anesthetic and nurse the sick. The Bahá'ís were imprisoned under horrendous conditions in a cluster of cells covered in excrement and dirt. Abdu'l-Bahá himself fell dangerously ill with dysentery, however a sympathetic soldier permitted a physician to help cure him. The population shunned them, the soldiers treated them the same, and the behavior of Syed Muhammad Isfahani, an Azali, did not help matters. Morale was further destroyed with the accidental death of Abdu'l-Bahá's youngest brother Mirza Mahdi at the age of 22. His death devastated the family, particularly his mother and father, and the grieving Abdu'l-Bahá kept a night-long vigil beside his brother's body. Over time, he gradually took over responsibility for the relationships between the small Baha'i exile community and the outside world. It was through his interaction with the people of Akká, Acre, that, according to the Baha'is, they recognized the innocence of the Baha'is, and thus the conditions of imprisonment were eased. 4 months after the death of Mahdi, the family moved from the prison to the house of Abbas. The people of Akká started to respect the Baha'is and in particular, Abdu'l-Bahá. Abdu'l-Bahá was able to arrange for houses to be rented for the family. The family later moved to the mansion of Baji around 1879 when an epidemic caused the inhabitants to flee. Abdu'l-Bahá soon became very popular in the penal colony, and Myron Henry Phelps, a wealthy New York lawyer, described how a crowd of human beings, Syrians, Arabs, Ethiopians, and many others, all waited to talk and receive Abdu'l-Bahá. He undertook a history of the Babi religion through publication of A Traveler's Narrative, Makalah-i-Sheikh Sisayah, in 1886, later translated and published in translation in 1891 through Cambridge University by the agency of Edward Granville Brown, who described Abdu'l-Bahá as: "When Abdu'l-Bahá was a young man, speculation was rife amongst the Baha'is to whom he would marry. Several young girls were seen as marriage prospects, but Abdu'l-Bahá seemed disinclined to marriage. On March 8, 1873, at the urging of his father, the 28-year-old Abdu'l-Bahá married Fatimi Narayaf Isfahan, 1847-1938, a 25-year-old from an upper-class family of the city. Her father was Mirza Muhammad Ali Nari of Isfahan, an eminent Baha'i with prominent connections. Fatimi was brought from Persia to Akká after both Baha'u'lláh and his wife Nawab expressed an interest in her to marry Abdu'l-Bahá. After a wearisome journey from Isfahan to Akká, she finally arrived accompanied by her brother in 1872. The young couple were betrothed for about 5 months before the marriage itself commenced. In the meantime, Fatimi lived in the home of Abdu'l-Bahá's uncle Mirza Musa. According to her later memoirs, Fatimi fell in love with Abdu'l-Bahá on seeing him. Abdu'l-Bahá himself had showed little inkling to marriage until meeting Fatimi, who was entitled Muniri by Baha'u'llah. Muniri is a title meaning luminous. The marriage resulted in 9 children. The firstborn was a son Mahdi Effendi who died aged about 3. He was followed by Dayewi Khanum, Fuadiyi Khanum, d. few years old, Ruangas Khanum, d. 1893, Tuba Khanum, Hussein Effendi, d. 1887 aged 5, Tuba Khanum, Rua Khanum, and Munavar Khanum. The death of his children caused Abdu'l-Bahá immense grief. In particular, the death of his son Hussein Effendi came at a difficult time following death of his mother and uncle. The surviving children, all daughters, were Dayewi Khanum, mother of Shoghi Effendi, d. 1951, Tuba Khanum, 1880-1959, Rua Khanum and Munavar Khanum, d. 1971. Baha'u'llah wished that the Baha'is follow the example of Abdu'l-Bahá and gradually move away from polygamy. The marriage of Abdu'l-Bahá to one woman and his choice to remain monogamous, from advice of his father and his own wish, legitimized the practice of monogamy to a people who hitherto had regarded polygamy as a righteous way of life. After Baha'u'llah died on May 29, 1892, the will and testament of Baha'u'llah named Abdu'l-Bahá as center of the covenant, successor and interpreter of Baha'u'llah's writings. Baha'u'llah designates his successor with the following verses. This translation of the Kitabiyat is based on a solecism, however, as the terms Akbar and Azam do not mean, respectively, greater and most great apostrophe. Not only do the two words derive from entirely separate triconsonantal roots, Akbar from KBR and Azam from ZM, but the Arabic language possesses the elative, a stage of gradation, with no clear distinction between the comparative and superlative. In the will and testament, Abdu'l-Bahá's half-brother, Muhammad Ali, was mentioned by name as being subordinate to Abdu'l-Bahá. Muhammad Ali became jealous of his half-brother and set out to establish authority for himself as an alternative leader with the support of his brothers Badullah and Diyullah. He began correspondence with Baha'is in Iran, initially in secret, casting doubts in others' minds about Abdu'l-Bahá. While most Baha'is followed Abdu'l-Bahá, a handful followed Muhammad Ali, including such leaders as Mirza Javad and Ibrahim George Kerala, an early Baha'i missionary to America. Muhammad Ali and Mirza Javad began to openly accuse Abdu'l-Bahá of taking on too much authority, suggesting that he believed himself to be a manifestation of God, equal in status to Baha'u'llah. It was at this time that Abdu'l-Bahá, in order to provide proof of the falsity of the accusations leveled against him, in tablets to the West, stated that he was to be known as Abdu'l-Bahá, an Arabic phrase meaning the servant of Bahá, to make it clear that he was not a manifestation of God, and that his station was only servitude. Abdu'l-Bahá left a will and testament that set up the framework of administration. The two highest institutions were the Universal House of Justice, and the Guardianship, for which he appointed Shoghi Effendi as the guardian. With the exception of Abdu'l-Bahá and Shoghi Effendi, Muhammad Ali was supported by all of the remaining male relatives of Baha'u'llah, including Shoghi Effendi's father, Mirza Hadi Shirazi. However, Muhammad Ali's and his family's statements had very little effect on the Baha'is in general in the Akka area. The followers of Muhammad Ali represented six families at most, they had no common religious activities, and were almost wholly assimilated into a Muslim society. By the end of 1898, Western pilgrims started coming to Akka on pilgrimage to visit Abdu'l-Bahá. This group of pilgrims, including Phoebe Hearst, was the first time that Baha'is raised up in the West had met Abdu'l-Bahá. The first group arrived in 1898, and throughout late 1898 to early 1899 Western Baha'is sporadically visited Abdu'l-Bahá. The group was relatively young, containing mainly women from high American society in their 20s. The group of Westerners aroused suspicion for the authorities, and consequently Abdu'l-Bahá's confinement was tightened. During the next decade Abdu'l-Bahá would be in constant communication with Baha'is around the world, helping them to teach the religion. The group included May Alice Bowles in Paris, Englishman Thomas Brakewell, American Herbert Hopper, French, Susan Moody, Louis Getzinger, and American Laura Clifford Barney. It was Laura Clifford Barney who, by asking questions of Abdu'l-Bahá over many years and many visits to Haifa, compiled what later became the book Some Answered Questions. During the final years of the 19th century, while Abdu'l-Bahá was still officially a prisoner and confined to Akka, he organized the transfer of the remains of the Bab from Iran to Palestine. He then organized the purchase of land on Mount Carmel that Baha'u'llah had instructed should be used to lay the remains of the Bab, and organized for the construction of the Shrine of the Bab. This process took another 10 years. With the increase of pilgrims visiting Abdu'l-Bahá, Muhammad Ali worked with the Ottoman authorities to reintroduce stricter terms on Abdu'l-Bahá's imprisonment in August 1901. By 1902, however, due to the governor of Akka being supportive of Abdu'l-Bahá, the situation was greatly eased. While pilgrims were able to once again visit Abdu'l-Bahá, he was confined to the city. In February 1903, two followers of Muhammad Ali, including Badullah and Sayyid Ali Afnan, broke with Muhammad Ali and wrote books and letters giving details of Muhammad Ali's plots and noting that what was circulating about Abdu'l-Bahá was fabrication. From 1902 to 1904, in addition to the building of the Shrine of the Bab that Abdu'l-Bahá was directing, he started to put into execution two different projects: the restoration of the House of the Bab in Shiraz, Iran, and the construction of the first Baha'i House of Worship in Ashgabat, Turkmenistan. Abdu'l-Bahá asked Akka Mirza Akka to coordinate the work so that the House of the Bab would be restored to the state that it was at the time of the Bab's declaration to Mullah Hussein in 1844. He also entrusted the work on the House of Worship to Vakil Udali. During this period, Abdu'l-Bahá communicated with a number of Young Turks, opposed to the reign of Sultan Abdulhamid II, including Nimp Kemal, Ziya Pasha, and Midhat Pasha, in an attempt to disseminate Baha'i thought into their political ideology. He emphasized Baha'is seek freedom and love liberty, hope for equality, are well-wishers of humanity and ready to sacrifice their lives to unite humanity, but on a more broad approach than the Young Turks. Abdul Asifdeh, one of the founders of the Committee of Union and Progress, who considered the Baha'i faith an intermediary step between Islam and the ultimate abandonment of religious belief, would go on trial for defense of Baha'is in a periodical he founded. Abdu'l-Bahá also had contact with military leaders as well, including such individuals as Bursal Mehmet Tahir Bey and Hassan Bedreddin. The latter, who was involved in the overthrow of Sultan Abdulaziz, is commonly known as Bedri Pasha or Bedri Pasha and is referred to in Persian Baha'i sources as Bedri Bey, Badri Beg. He was a Baha'i who translated Abdu'l-Bahá's works into French. Abdu'l-Bahá also met Muhammad Abdullah, one of the key figures of Islamic modernism and the Salafi movement, in Beirut, at a time when the two men were both opposed to the Ottoman ulama and shared similar goals of religious reform. Rashid Rad asserts that during his visits to Beirut, Abdu'l-Bahá would attend Abdullah's study sessions. Regarding the meetings of Abdu'l-Bahá and Muhammad Abdullah, Shoghi Effendi asserts that his several interviews with the well-known Sheikh Muhammad Abdu served to enhance immensely the growing prestige of the community and spread abroad the fame of its most distinguished member. Due to Abdu'l-Bahá's political activities and alleged accusation against him by Muhammad Ali, a commission of inquiry interviewed Abdu'l-Bahá in 1905, with the result that he was almost exiled to Fezzan. In response, Abdu'l-Bahá wrote the Sultan a letter protesting that his followers refrained from involvement in partisan politics and that his tariqa had guided many Americans to Islam. The next few years in Akká were relatively free of pressures and pilgrims were able to come and visit Abdu'l-Bahá. By 1909 the mausoleum of the Shrine of the Bab was completed. The 1908 Young Turks Revolution freed all political prisoners in the Ottoman Empire, and Abdu'l-Bahá was freed from imprisonment. His first action after his freedom was to visit the Shrine of Bahá'u'lláh in Baghdad. While Abdu'l-Bahá continued to live in Akká immediately following the revolution, he soon moved to live in Haifa near the Shrine of the Bab. In 1910, with the freedom to leave the country, he embarked on a three-year journey to Egypt, Europe, and North America, spreading the Bahá'í message. From August to December 1911, Abdu'l-Bahá visited cities in Europe, including London, Bristol, and Paris. The purpose of these trips was to support the Bahá'í communities in the West and to further spread his father's teachings. In the following year, he undertook a much more extensive journey to the United States and Canada to once again spread his father's teachings. He arrived in New York City on April 11, 1912, after declining an offer of passage on the RMS Titanic, telling the Bahá'í believers, instead, to donate this to charity. He instead traveled on a slower craft, the RMS Cedric, and cited preference of a longer sea journey as the reason. After hearing of the Titanic sinking on 16 April he was quoted as saying, "I was asked to sail upon the Titanic, but my heart did not prompt me to do so." While he spent most of his time in New York, he visited Chicago, Cleveland, Pittsburgh, Washington, D.C., Boston and Philadelphia. In August of the same year he started a more extensive journey to places including New Hampshire, the Green Acre School in Maine, and Montreal, his only visit to Canada. He then traveled west to Minneapolis, San Francisco, Stanford, and Los Angeles before starting to return east at the end of October. On December 5, 1912 he set sail back to Europe. During his visit to North America he visited many missions, churches, and groups, as well as having scores of meetings in Baha'i's homes, and offering innumerable personal meetings with hundreds of people. During his talks he proclaimed Baha'i principles such as the unity of God, unity of the religions, oneness of humanity, equality of women and men, world peace and economic justice. He also insisted that all his meetings be open to all races. His visit and talks were the subject of hundreds of newspaper articles. In Boston newspaper reporters asked Abdu'l-Bahá why he had come to America, and he stated that he had come to participate in conferences on peace and that just giving warning messages is not enough. Abdu'l-Bahá's visit to Montreal provided notable newspaper coverage. On the night of his arrival the editor of the Montreal Daily Star met with a Manhattan newspaper along with the Montreal Gazette, Montreal Standard, Le Devoir and La Presse among others reported on Abdu'l-Bahá's activities. The headlines in those papers included "Persian teacher to preach peace, racialism wrong, says Eastern sage, strife and war caused by religious and national prejudices, an apostle of peace meets socialists, Abdu'l-Bahá's novel scheme for distribution of surplus wealth." The Montreal Standard, which was distributed across Canada, took so much interest that it republished the articles a week later. The Gazette published six articles and Montreal's largest French-language newspaper published two articles about him. His 1912 visit to Montreal also inspired humorist Stephen Leacock to parody him in his best-selling 1914 book Arcadian Adventures with the Idle Rich. In Chicago one newspaper headline included "His Holiness Visits Us, Not Pius X but a Baha," and Abdu'l-Bahá's visit to California was reported in the Palo Alto. Back in Europe, he visited London, Paris, where he stayed for 2 months, Stuttgart, Budapest, and Vienna. Finally, on June 12, 1913, he returned to Egypt, where he stayed for 6 months before returning to Haifa. On February 23, 1914, at the eve of World War I, Abdu'l-Bahá hosted Baron Edmund James de Rothschild, a member of the Rothschild banking family who was a leading advocate and financier of the Zionist movement, during one of his early trips to Palestine. During World War I, 1914 to 1918, Abdu'l-Bahá stayed in Palestine and was unable to travel. He carried on a limited correspondence, which included the Tablets of the Divine Plan, a collection of 14 letters addressed to the Baha'is of North America, later described as one of three charters of the Bahá'í Faith. The letters assign a leadership role for the North American Baha'is in spreading the religion around the planet. Haifa was under real threat of Allied bombardment, enough that Abdu'l-Bahá and other Baha'is temporarily retreated to the hills east of Akká. Abdu'l-Bahá was also under threats from Jamal Pasha, the Ottoman military chief who at one point expressed his desire to crucify him and destroy Baha'i properties in Palestine. The surprisingly swift Megiddo offensive of the British general Allenby swept away the Turkish forces in Palestine before harm was done to the Baha'is, and the war was over less than 2 months later. The conclusion of World War I led to the openly hostile Ottoman authorities being replaced by the more friendly British mandate, allowing for a renewal of correspondence, pilgrims, and development of the Baha'i World Center properties. It was during this revival of activity that the Baha'i Faith saw an expansion and consolidation in places like Egypt, the Caucasus, Iran, Turkmenistan, North America and South Asia under the leadership of Abdu'l-Bahá. The end of the war brought about several political developments that Abdu'l-Bahá commented on. The League of Nations formed in January 1920, representing the first instance of collective security through a worldwide organization. Abdu'l-Bahá had written in 1875 for the need to establish a union of the nations of the world, and he praised the attempt through the League of Nations as an important step towards the goal. He also said that it was incapable of establishing universal peace because it did not represent all nations and had only trivial power over its member states. Around the same time, the British mandate supported the ongoing immigration of Jews to Palestine. Abdu'l-Bahá mentioned the immigration as a fulfillment of prophecy, and encouraged the Zionists to develop the land and elevate the country for all its inhabitants. They must not work to separate the Jews from the other Palestinians. The war also left the region in famine. In 1901, Abdu'l-Bahá had purchased about 1,704 acres of scrubland near the Jordan River, and by 1907 many Baha'is from Iran had begun sharecropping on the land. Abdu'l-Bahá received between 20-33% of their harvest, or cash equivalent, which was shipped to Haifa. With the war still raging in 1917, Abdu'l-Bahá received a large amount of wheat from the crops, and also bought other available wheat and shipped it all back to Haifa. The wheat arrived just after the British seized control, and the wheat was widely distributed to allay the famine. For this service in averting a famine in northern Palestine, he received a knighthood at a ceremony held in his honor at the home of the British governor on 27 April 1920. He was later visited by General Allenby, King Faisal, later King of Iraq, Herbert Samuel, High Commissioner for Palestine, and Ronald Storrs, military governor of Jerusalem. Abdu'l-Bahá died on Monday, November 28, 1921, sometime after 1:15 a.m., 27th of Rabi al-Awwal, 1340. Winston Churchill telegraphed the High Commissioner for Palestine, conveyed to the Baha'i community, on behalf of His Majesty's government, their sympathy and condolences. Similar messages came from Viscount Allenby, the Council of Ministers of Iraq, and others. On his funeral, which was held the next day, Esselmont notes among the talks delivered at the funeral, Shoghi Effendi records Stuart Sims giving the following tribute: he was buried in the front room of the Shrine of the Bab on Mount Carmel. His interment there is meant to be temporary, until his own mausoleum can be built. Abdu'l-Bahá left a will and testament that was originally written between 1901 to 1908 and addressed to Shoghi Effendi, who at that time was only 11 years old. The will appoints Shoghi Effendi as the first in a line of guardians of the religion, a hereditary executive role that may provide authoritative interpretations of scripture. Abdu'l-Bahá directed all Baha'is to turn to him and obey him, and assured him of divine protection and guidance. The will also provided a formal reiteration of his teachings, such as the instructions to teach, manifest spiritual qualities, associate with all people, and shun covenant breakers. Many obligations of the Universal House of Justice and the Hands of the Cause were also elaborated. Shoghi Effendi later described the document as one of three charters of the Baha'i Faith. The authenticity and provisions of the will were almost universally accepted by Baha'is around the world, with the exception of Ruth White and a few other Americans who tried to protest Shoghi Effendi's leadership. During his lifetime there was some ambiguity among Baha'is as to his station relative to Baha'u'llah, and later to Shoghi Effendi. Some American newspapers reported him to be a Baha'i prophet or the return of Christ. Shoghi Effendi later formalized his legacy as the last of three central figures of the Bahá'í Faith and the perfect exemplar of the teachings, also claiming that holding him on an equal status to Bahá'u'lláh or Jesus was heretical. Shoghi Effendi also wrote that during the anticipated Bahá'í dispensation of 1,000 years there will be no equal to Abdu'l-Bahá. The total estimated number of tablets that Abdu'l-Bahá wrote are over 27,000, of which only a fraction have been translated into English. His works fall into two groups, including first his direct writings and second his lectures and speeches as noted by others. The first group includes The Secret of Divine Civilization, written before 1875, A Traveler's Narrative, written around 1886, The Risale Yesiasiya or Sermon on the Art of Governance, written in 1893, The Memorials of the Faithful, and a large number of tablets written to various people, including various Western intellectuals such as Auguste Forel, which has been translated and published as the Tablet to Auguste Henri Forel. The Secret of Divine Civilization and the Sermon on the Art of Governance were widely circulated anonymously. The second group includes Some Answered Questions, which is an English translation of a series of table talks with Laura Barney, and Paris Talks, Abdu'l-Bahá in London and Promulgation of Universal Peace, which are respectively addresses given by Abdu'l-Bahá in Paris, London and the United States. The following is a list of some of Abdu'l-Bahá's many books, tablets, and talks. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.